Is phosphorus good for my plants? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. You're here with Mark Batwell at PerfectGardens.com. To explain this product, I decided to reach out to my buddy, Mr. Volkman. Even though he does not use this nutrient line, he's someone I use as a resource to help me comprehend and understand and get a deeper awareness to a broad spectrum and topics. I'm including a couple pictures in his current grow that he is doing right now. As you can see, his plants are beautiful. He's not using this nutrient line, although he is definitely someone that enjoys gardening and does a great job, and once again, has a very deep understanding around minerals specifically. So let's go ahead and get into the conversation, because I think it was better that we had this conversation than for me to just break it down by myself. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. And if you ever are interested in donating, please check out the links down below. I would also like to know if you guys would be interested in me setting up some type of a program where you guys could reach out to me directly via text and I answer your questions as you need. Let me know. I'm thinking about charging a few dollars a month where you'll be able to text me and I'll be able to get back to you within 24 to 48 hours. If you're interested in that, please leave a comment down below. Love to hear what you guys think about the idea.
Hello.
Hey, bro.
Hey, what's up?
Man, a quick question. Phosphorus?
Yeah.
Phosphate.
Yeah.
Okay, so an important source of is phosphate rock. So they derive phosphorus from phosphate rock. Okay, so phosphate rock is, and I read this, I'm just trying to find the right words, and I thought by talking to you, I might be able to think of it slightly differently as well. That's what I'm, the gist of this conversation, because I'm working on a video for one of my things. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is, one of the raw products, their phosphorus product, like NPK, comes from monoammonium phosphate. And so obviously that's a chemical, and that's because they synthesize the product, the raw phosphate rock, down to this product. Because it's a phosphate, they use phosphoric acid to derive it.
Well, that's how you create phosphoric acid, is through phosphorus.
Okay, and phosphoric acid is a man-made chemical. It's not a naturally occurring mineral chemical, correct?
Yeah, it's an acid. Phosphoric acid is an acid. Well, it can occur naturally. What you look up is a natural, it's like sulfuric acid. It occurs naturally, but it's always mixing with something in nature, so you don't find it like in its pure form, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like the difference between the pure form, which would be like them creating it in a lab before, you think of it in terms of like when you're pH downing the calcium, right? Like the rock dust, for instance. That phosphoric acid will bind and dissolve the calcium magnesium, so they're no longer like rock dust. They're now like they're more dissolved, like a salt, right? So they become a dissolved solid. So the phosphoric acid is no longer phosphoric acid anymore. It's clung to whatever it's dissolved, and now it's a part of something else. So it just depends on what you're reacting it with, and it'll never be phosphoric acid once you've added it to the water and mixed it with other nutrients, if that makes sense.
It does.
It'll become a complex.
It does. And where I think maybe it might, a good approach to trying to explain this video might just be like, what's happening when people create these nutrient lines is to, instead of just giving you a bag of minerals and telling you to keep your microbiology together, and it's just a mixed bag of minerals and letting your microbiology sort it out, they are separating everything out. It's like a refining process and trying to extract one specific thing, and then when you extract it and you put it into a concentrated form, they separate it, put it into its own bag, and then they sell you nitrogen, they sell you phosphorus, they sell you potassium. And that's the way how they make money. And that's really, you know, and there's nothing wrong with that, because in nature, these things happen naturally. And nature, you don't really get this ideal exact experience, because you're dealing with elements and nature and wind and sun and cold days, rain and all these things. But then at the end of the year, you get what you get. But because so much money is being invested in this industry, there is more room to be more exact. And what you're doing is you're removing all these other things we're not going to say that the plant doesn't need, because we're realizing
let's take a step back, because we really want to make sure we understand that, you know, people try to achieve this thing where they call it like a natural microbiome or, you know, living soil or whatever. But the reality is, it doesn't matter where you go in the world, no two soils are the same.
Agreed.
So there's really nothing to achieve other than a healthy environment. Really, you know, really, it's like the optimal healthy environment. Well, what are the tools to do that, right? And we only know so much, so we have to add the things that we know that our grow is lacking that we can see, right?
Mm-hmm.
So a lot we can't see because it's in the dirt. So even if you're talking about, you know, whether you're growing in California soil, which is going to be more alkaline, you're going to have to add more acid because desert regions tend to have more alkaline soils, right? And we know California used to be a floodplain, so it had mineral salts, so that's where the fertility came, but you're still dealing with a higher alkaline soil when you're trying to grow, so you have to add more acid. So one of the number one products used in California for commercial agriculture is sulfuric acid, so they can lower the pH of the soil. And then whatever else you might add that it's missing compared to where you would find another optimal soil in the Midwest, right? So you can't, it's really, people are trying to achieve this false, you know, name. It's really about play on words. And we need to just focus on balance, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like your name drops the balance. It's more about finding the equilibrium, not only to what medium you're using, but the altitude. And, you know, no two grains are going to, things are going to be identical, and you'll always have, and even the genetics of the plant, right? You know that, from one will eat way more nitrogen than the other, or one will eat way more phosphorus, or, you know, you never know. You know, it's become more of like an art, I think, is what you're saying. It's like, this is more like an art, and we're, you know, trying to achieve maximum efficiency. Rather than trying to talk about all these play on words that people are just confused about. Living soil, put worms in there. Well, yeah, any soil in the ground, if it's fertile, will have worms, right?
Mm-hmm.
If it's dead, it won't have anything. You'll just find dust and rock hard ground, right? You have to bring it back to life. Well, you bring back that soil to life the same way you bring back any other soil to life.
Absolutely.
Right? So it's not a magic trick or anything like that. I just think these, you know, isolates and things are really about helping people fine-tune. That's really, and not everybody's going to be using the same products either. Unless it's like a core base nutrient or a core base medium, or, you know, that's different, right? But if you're trying to dial in and, like, you're talking about the different phosphorus products, pretty much a lot of them are identical and you're just paying for the brand name.
In many situations where... The one thing that I do notice that the raw nutrient line does do really well is that they do take into consideration what does shut you down, your microbiology, and the higher parts per million. Their whole nutrient line keeps everything they're using. I'm not saying that they're all natural. I'm just saying that they use products. They can use products that are derived from sulfuric acid, a stronger acid. They do. If they are using a product like another synthetic fertilizer, they're doing their best to use the highest quality or highest purity, because there's different purities even when they're extracting the different chemicals and synthesizing it. So they're actually using certain things. And also, and I'm just giving you another example, like they add a little bit of ammonium nitrate, not urea, ammonium nitrate into this product as well, which is you get a little bit of a boost in the beginning, but it's more of like a slow release, which again is in line with not destroying your microbiology. And so again, like you're saying, there is nutrient lines that have a cognitive dissonance reality. Everything, what they recommend is actually the opposite, and why they shouldn't recommend other products in their nutrient line. And it's obvious they're trying to rip you off, because it instantly shuts anything of value down in these other products. But in this situation, what makes them slightly different is, like, they're bordering the edge of using synthetic nutrients, the highest quality synthetic nutrients, and also trying to use microbiology and the best of both worlds. And
I think that's important.
It is.
Because that's where you get rid of those chemical type smells and flavors as well.
Yeah, and you max your yield, terpenes, profiles, all of that. That's like, if you want to get the best top shelf material or even fruit, vegetables, whatever, you are going to provide everything the plant needs in the highest possible quality form.
Well, the funniest thing is, and I've been saying this, and this is going to be funny, we're going to all laugh at ourselves when we realize that it was our piss that was the best.
Oh, yeah, totally. Totally. This is movies.
Your urine has all the active enzymes, all of the everything the soil needs, your urine has.
I actually shot a video on this a while back where I was like, exactly what you said. I couldn't say any better. I said those exact words. They don't want you to know. All you got to do is collect your piss, dilute it, and feed your plants.
And the craziest thing, I think the biggest part is people, first reaction, ew, I'm going to be a piss. But you're sitting there pouring bat poop and bird poop. It's like, really?
And in
I can understand if you're eating Hot Pockets every day, you might want to be worried about that.
Funny you said that, too. I was like, exactly. It's like, and if you want to increase the quality of pee or fertilizer to your plants, you just have to eat healthier and be healthier. And then your plants, you're going to have a higher quality product at the end of the year.
Well, you know where that works out the best was I was watching this guy, how to break down leaves. You know how you can collect the crap little leaves and they stay in a pile forever. If you pee on the leaves, it breaks them down like 10 times faster.
It's so interesting that life has given us everything we need. And the only reason why urine becomes toxic or feces or any of these other things is because of the concentration and the...
Yeah, you just dilute it down.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And we take these things and we call them toxins because we ship them and isolate them down to where it becomes toxic, you know, versus teaching us how to use our own extremities. I hate to say it like that, but yeah.
From what I heard, too, is that using your own urine and stuff will actually tell the plant what you're lacking, and the plant will actually provide, in your garden, your plant will actually know what to do to heal you, know what you're deficient in and know what you're missing.
That's so interesting. Think about aquaponics.
Your urine lets them know who you are and what you're about. It's like a genetic, it's like giving them your fingerprint and letting them know what's going on. Let your plants be your doctor, right? Give them your urine. Give them a sample.
It's
crazy, though, when you really start breaking that down.
Two things to add. First, aquaponics, exactly what we were saying, pee, urine. I'm just trying to relate it. And second, also is, it's a joke, kind of. Whenever I go into the restroom, they tell you to wash your hands, right? But everyone knows now that there's more germs on the faucet and the handle you open the door than it is on yourself. So really, it's actually cleaner to just not wash your hands because I know where my body has been the whole day. I know I'm not dirty. You know what I mean? I don't know where all the other places have been. And it's a joke, but it's also what we're saying is I'm trying to create, in some level, a realization that your own extremities are actually, when they come out sterile. A lot of people don't know that. It's your urine is sterile. It's clean. It's the cleanest it's ever been. When I was in the military, and they would said that if you ever come into a gut wound and you don't have any sterile water or IV solution,
use your urine.
It's not going to cause a problem. It's hilarious.
Not only that, but if you think about this, your hands, the pH of your skin.
It's acidic.
It's 5.6.
Yep.
It's 5.6, so it kills bacteria. So if you wash your hands with this alkaline soap, you're killing all the good bacteria, and you're raising the pH, and now your hands are susceptible.
Absolutely.
It has nothing to even do with whether you're clean or not. It's whether or not your field is in balance. And if you take your field out of balance, there you go. So you could touch poop, you could stick your hand in a pile of poo, you can jump in sewage as long as your body's got that pH, you better get out fast, right? But your body's designed to handle that. But when you wash it and you scrub away all of what's built up on your hands, people would have dry hands because they wash their hands all the time.
I mean, your skin is
a
filter.
When I wash my hands, I only use water. I don't use soap ever.
I agree, me too. Your skin is a filter too. It's created to block pathogens cannot get in through your skin.
Yep.
It's amazing.
Even if you feel like there's a little bit of pink in your eye, you just throw some water in there and it rinses right out.
When you're dehydrated and you go into the hospital, they give you water.
Yeah. They give you an IV right away.
I'm going to call you back. I got a couple more calls that just came in.
Okay, no problem. All right, I'll talk to you in a little bit.
Thank you, bro. Bye.
Bye.